Good afternoon, everybody. I hope you revised the first lecture. In that first lecture, we defined the limit. We also motivated why we wanted to look at the concept and also looked at some examples how to prove that rigorously using epsilon delta. I hope you are reasonably comfortable with that. Now there are two options open to me. Remember, my series of lectures is geared towards understanding the notion of calculus from R2 to R, R3 to R, or in general Rn to R. So I am preparing the ground for that, right? So for that, the notion of limit is also an important concept. And second, so yeah, there are two options now. So do you want me to go into functions from R2 to R now, or shall I take another 15 minutes to explain the notion of differentiability of a function from R to R? This will help us to understand when we come to differentiability of functions from R2 to R. Okay, I can do it at that time also, but I thought if I do it today, 2 days break, so it will sink better. You will have time to absorb that idea. So up to your choice. The first choice is functions from R2 to R. Those who want that should say yes. Those who want to have a look at the differentiability of function from R to R with a different perspective should choose no. Okay, I would like to hear from all of you. Because whatever options I give, I forget. So somebody has to remind me. What is the option no for functions from R2 to R?
For differentiability, sir. For differentiability.
Oh, differentiability.
No, it's yes. R to R differentiability.
Oh, I see. See, I already forgot. Okay.
Oh, okay.
Thank you very much. Then, okay, we will do that. Okay. Hopefully, within 15 minutes or 20 minutes, I will be able to do that. And after that, we will move on to functions from R to R. Okay. So let me share the screen. I hope it is there. Yeah. Yeah. So let me quickly recall the standard definition as we have seen in 12th standard, again in BSc. I have function f. I will write it from R to R. Okay. It could be an interval j from R to R, j in interval. Okay. To understand, it does not matter. So let us assume f is a function from R to R, a is a function point in R. I want to say f is differentiable at a. If this is what you did, limit x tends to a of f of x minus f of a by x minus a exists, and if it exists, call it f dash a. Okay, so this is your a. Your x is somewhere near, maybe here or anywhere near to a. And of course, whenever you write, x is not equal to a. Sometime you might have seen it in slightly different notation. Whenever I have an x here, I can write x as a plus h for some real number h, right? Namely, h equal to x minus a. Therefore, this you might have sometimes seen it in this fashion. F of a, x is a plus h minus f of a by h exists. And if it exists, call it f dash a. This is the standard definition. Since we already understood what is meant by a limit of a function, this makes sense to us, right? But what I want to do is, first I want to enunciate the principle and then interpret that using that principle. Okay, just think about, you know, it's always good to sit back and think about, introspect. So if I give a function f from R to R, how many such functions I know? If you really think about, you'll be surprised. You'll know only essentially polynomial functions, right? And next, perhaps modulus function, and therefore composite, product, algebraic manipulations of these things. And next, you also know what are called the transcendental function. They are exponential function, log, whatever is the domain. Okay, I'm not writing trigonometric functions and hyperbolic functions. Okay, these are the See, if you really look at these transcendental functions, what we know is how to work with them. There is no rigorous definition of any of these things in general. Okay? Because it takes almost one semester of a subject called analysis to make rigorous definition for any of these things. But what we do in calculus is we learn how to work with that. Okay? Please try to understand, I am coming to that. So, now these are the at best known function, but F from R to R could be any function. So there are just too many functions. Okay. Now, if I want to understand the function, how do I do that? The way to do that is, suppose there is a VIP and you are a small person. You want to get to know about this guy. What do? You look for a guy who is in between, who is close to you, and he is also close to the VIP. Then try to approach, okay, this guy. Okay, you get your job done. You understand that? So that's what we want to do. If you give me some arbitrary function F from R to R, I would like to approximate this F by means of some functions whose behavior I know, like polynomials, modulus, or perhaps even transcendental functions. Okay? Through that, I want to understand this. So this is unknown function. This is something like a known function. And this is me or you. Okay? This is what you want to do. This is vague enough? Good. We'll do that. Now, let us look at. Suppose F is a function from R to R, right? Let me rewrite the above notation. F limit x tends to a, f of x minus f of a by x minus a. Let us call it equal to f dash a. Okay? Assume F is differentiable at a and the derivative exists. Now let's rewrite. What is the definition of this limit? You are going to give me an epsilon. Okay. This is my f dash a. So I am formulating f dash a minus epsilon, f dash a plus epsilon. Okay. This I am not writing. Okay. So there is a delta positive so that you start with any a and a minus delta to a plus delta. Take any x which is not equal to a, then what do I want to say? Fx minus fa such that mod x minus a less than delta 0. Okay. Minus f dash a must be less than epsilon. This is our definition of limit. This is a notation. This notation stands for this very precise way of writing. Given f dash a, formulate the epsilon interval. Then there is a delta interval around a, start with any x. Then let's look at this quotient fx minus fa by x minus a. This function is close to f dash a. This number is close to f dash a. Do you understand this? Okay. Now what I want to do is, this is where the slightly different perspective comes. Let us clear up the fraction. If I clear up the fraction, what do I get? Fx minus fa minus f dash a into x minus a is less than epsilon times mod x minus a. If 0 less than mod x minus a less than delta. Implies this. Do all of you agree with that? Yeah? If I put this, I can also allow this. Because x equal to a also is true. Do you understand all of you? Because if x equal to a, this will be fa minus fa 0. This is 0. And it you want to say it's less than epsilon x minus a. If x equal to a, this will be 0. Therefore, you cannot say 0 is strictly less than 0. So I put less than I equal to. If you don't like, put 0 strict and then remove this. Okay. Do you understand this? Now I want to go back to your 12th standard. I'm sure if you write x a equal to x plus h, the word h, your teacher would have used a word for this h. He would have said it's an increment. Increment in what? In the independent variable x. In the independent variable. Okay. X value at a is what we are doing. Therefore, it is an increment in the independent variable. Right? Now, suppose I write fx equal to y f of x plus h, again I can write as y plus k, where k is f of x plus h minus f of x. You understand? Then what do you call this k? This k is called increment in the dependent variable. All these things I am sure that you would have seen in your 12th standard, except you would have forgotten. Because after that we did lot of computation, the theory was lost. Okay, do you understand this? Yeah. Now let us look at this. Therefore, what is this? This is the increment in the dependent variable. This is f of x equal to y plus k, f of a is y, therefore it's k. That is, therefore this is the increment in the independent variable. And what is this then? This is the increment in the dependent variable. So what do you think you have done? You have done that fx minus fa, this is the increment in the dependent variable. You want to say it's approximately equal to some f dash a into x minus a. That is constant multiple of increment in the independent variable. Just look at it, do not get intimidated. Okay, just pay attention. 30 to 40%, that's good enough. Slowly it will get absorbed in your mind. Okay, in other words, let us look at fx. I want to say it's approximately equal to f of a into f dash of a into x minus a. If f dash of a, call it some lambda equal to f dash a. Now look at f is some unknown function, it is differentiable at a, but what have I got on the right side? This is a constant fa, then a scalar multiple of a first degree polynomial in x minus a. Do you understand that? Yeah, see, look at this. I am rewriting this fx minus of fa plus f dash a into x minus a, right? You understand that this is what I am calling. So just to make sure that you are following, this is the object I am doing. So if I take minus n out, then it will be plus. You understand? So I am saying fx is approximate to a first degree polynomial in x minus a. Do you understand this? Now notice that f is some function, very complicated function possibly, but then the moment you say f is differentiable at a, then for all x near a, the function fx is approximately equal to the first degree polynomial. Polynomial in which variable? Not in x, in x minus a. That is a polynomial in the increment, in the independent variable. How many of you have some vague understanding of this? About 30 to 40% is good enough for me. Please say yes if you understood. Do not raise hand unless you want to ask doubts now. Hereafter, you should use only yes. Okay. And do not worry about understanding 100%. That will come by and by. You understood that? So the first thing from this inequality, from this thing, what I got is fx is approximately equal to first degree polynomial. This polynomial. Where is, what is lambda? Lambda is the derivative of f at a. And polynomial in which variable? X minus a. That's it. This is how you should break. Whatever you read, anything new, you break it to small pieces, understand. Okay. Now, why do I say it's approximately equal to? Because you are saying it is less than some pre-assigned epsilon. This is the error you are allowing, and you say it is less than some error. Okay. Therefore, it's an approximation. This is what I explained in the first day. Right, let's go one step further. Now remember, I said whenever I say something, I have an x and I say it's approximately equal to a, then what should I be worried about? Whenever I say x is approximately equal to a, I should be worried about controlling the error. What is the error? Error is x minus a. And how do I control? In absolute value. So I have to have a control over x minus a. Now go back. So you say fx, okay, this is approximately equal to that. Therefore, what is the error now in this case? Error in this case is fx minus whatever the approximation, that is f of a minus lambda into x minus a. Remember, lambda is f dash a, right? So what do I want to say? I have to estimate this. Now, have I estimated? Go back. I estimated it. I estimated it saying it is less than epsilon times x minus a. For which x? For all x, so that 0 less than delta. Okay. Have you understood this much? Okay. Now, I want to look at something else. I will come back to this. All of you know, let us look at the sequence 1 by n and the sequence 1 by n squared. Where do they converge to?
0.
I'm sure all of you know this converges to 0. This also converges to 0. Right? But intuitively, which do you think converges faster?
1 by
which of them converges faster?
1 by
Can somebody from the audience unmute and say the answer? Does the sequence 1 by n converge faster or 1 by n squared converge faster to 0?
Sir, 1 by n squared converge faster.
Very good. Good. That's excellent. Now let's look at another function. Suppose I have a function fx equal to x squared and gx equal to x. Okay. What is the limit of x goes to 0 of fx and what is the limit of x goes to 0 of gx? I'm sure all of you again know the answer. The answer is 0. Now, can another student tell me which one of them go to 0 faster? F goes faster or G goes faster? Another student, please.
Sir, F.
F, right? Yeah. So, F goes faster. G going to 0. Okay. Now you see that this is what calculus and analysis deals with. You are trying to compare two functions. Okay. And you want to look at the behavior. Both you will say it goes to 0. That's correct. But you want to say which goes to faster, slower. It's like saying that, you know, when you want to go travel from place A to B, do you want to take express train or Shatabdi or I'm on a passenger? Like that. So you want to know which one. So we want to do that. Now let's go back. Now how do I determine? This is the intuition, right? When you said this goes to 0 faster or this goes to 0 faster, it's intuition, right? Because if I take n sufficient 1 by 10, whereas this will be 1 by 100. Therefore, this is closer to 0. And similarly here. Okay, that's all fine. But how do I make it rigorous? So I want to make a rigorous definition. Are all of you with me now? We are end of the tunnel. Just tag along for a while. Okay. So I want to say, assume limit x tends to a of fx is 0 and limit x tends to a of gx equal to 0. Then I say, yep. Okay, f goes to 0 faster, then g goes to 0 as x tends to a. If, this is the definition we are making, if limit x tends to a of fx by gx must be 0. Do you understand that? Let's look at the earlier definition. Mm-hmm. What was our fx? X squared. What was our gx? X. Then what is fx by gx? X squared by x. Therefore, limit x tends to 0. Oh, this is x tends to, yeah, x tends to a, right. Okay. So I know limit x tends to 0 of f is 0 is limit x tends to 0 of g is 0. And this goes faster. That means limit x tends to 0 of fx by gx, which is limit x goes to 0 of x squared by x, which is limit x goes to 0 of x, that is 0. Therefore, this goes to 0 faster. Do you understand that? So hereafter, this is the crucial thing. Okay, this definition is very crucial. Please understand. Spend some time. I have limit x tends to a of f(x) is zero, and similarly limit x tends to a of g(x) is also zero. I want to say f goes to zero faster than g goes to zero as x tends to a, if what our intuition now we are making it a rigorous definition. If you find out the limit of x going to a of f(x) by g(x), if it is zero, notice that when I say it is equal to zero, the limit should exist, and the limit should be zero. Then only I can say f(x) goes to zero faster than g(x). How many have understood this definition? Say yes. Again, about 40% is more than enough. 40% of understanding. I want 90% of all of you to say that. Let's look at, if you want, the same thing. 1 by n squared by 1 by n. This will be 1 by n squared by n by 1, which is 1 by n. So that goes to 0. See, the pattern is the same. Which? Right? Can you say yes, please? How many of you followed? Oh, it was very difficult. Okay, let me ask a question to make sure that you follow. Let's look at f of x equal to x power n, g of x equal to x power m, where m, n are natural numbers. Okay, if I say f, okay, g goes to zero faster than f going to zero as x goes to zero, what?
M has to be bigger than n.
No, the unfortunate thing is, let me make the thing different, because n, m, everything may sound similar. So n and k. So what can you conclude about the relation between n and k? This also goes to zero.
K is greater than n.
K is greater than n. You are right. Because then x power k divided by x power n. You understand this? This is how you should learn. Something you start, look at very simple minded examples, try to learn. So if I want to say this, what should I check? I have to check limit x tend to zero of gx by fx. But what is that object? That object is x power k by x power n. This is x power n minus k. I want to say this goes to zero. When it will go to zero? If n equal to k, it is 1. It cannot go to zero. If n is greater than k, this will be positive, right? Then it will go to zero. If n is less than k, this will be negative. It will be something like 1 by x, some positive power. So the reason is in k. How many of you understand this? Please say yes if you understand. Okay, good. Right. Now come back to this. What have I observed? Nidhi? Yes? Nidhi? You have some questions?
No, sir. Mistake.
Okay, no problem. Now let's come back to this. I said fx is approximately equal to f of a plus f dash a into x minus a. Therefore, I am approximating this unknown function around a by means of a first degree polynomial. That is very easy for me to deal with. And the polynomial is in the variable x minus a. Very good. Now, if I am approximating, I am making an error. You understand that? So, this is the error. So, I want to estimate the error. We have got it. You understand? Now, let's go back and do little more and come back to this. So, let us assume limit x tends to a of fx by gx is 0. What does this mean? According to our definition, it means for given any epsilon positive, I can choose a delta positive so that 0 less than mod x minus a less than delta. Again, always keep the picture in mind. Okay, x will be somewhere here. Then what do I want? Modulus fx by gx minus 0. This should be less than epsilon. This is same as saying mod fx is less than epsilon times mod gx. For this. Do you understand this? I am rewriting this. If f goes to 0 faster than g going to 0, that means in some delta interval around a for all x, fx mod fx should be less than epsilon times mod gx. Do you understand? I rewrote the definition. I am stopping every time very small point so that at least 30-40% you should be comfortable. Later you can always do it in the discussion hour and review it. Are you happy with this? Say yes if you understand. Again, about 30-40-50% is more than enough for me. Right? Now let's go back. So now the error I am making, the increment f of x minus f of a minus f dash f a into x minus a, this is the error, and I said is less than epsilon times mod x minus a. Right? Notice that this says this goes to 0, this also goes to 0 as x tends to a, but this goes to 0 faster than this going to 0. Do you understand this? I am just drawing the picture. Please understand. Let us look at the LHS. LHS left side is fx minus f of a minus f dash of a into x minus a. This is the error in absolute value. What we say is error goes to 0 as x minus a goes to 0. You understand that? But when both of them go to 0, I may want to say, does anyone go to 0 faster? It may or may not happen. But what we are shown is, this is like your mod fx is less than epsilon times mod gx in the delta interval around a. That means f goes to 0 faster than g. So what does it mean? This error goes to 0 faster than the increment going to 0. That means not only we approximated fx by means of a first degree polynomial, we also said the error I am making goes to 0. Yes, that is to be expected as x goes to a. But what I want to say, it goes to 0 faster than x going to a or mod x minus a going to 0. Okay, I'll put a pause, review, proceed, and we will move to the two variable case. Take some time, do not be in a hurry. Anything new, learning curve is always be slightly steeper, and this is also I want to teach you with a lot of in depth and subtlety. Okay, so don't feel disheartened, spend some time, go slow, understand. For about 15-20 seconds, I'll keep quiet, just go through this. Once you have some kind of an idea, say yes. So please review this during your breakout room. As soon as the lecture is over, I will try to make the PDF and send it to you. So forget all these things. Now what did you do? Just think of only this. Don't worry about the rest of the things. Look at this. Fx is approximately equal to this first degree polynomial. Therefore, the difference will be the error. That goes to zero. Faster than mod x minus a going to zero. That's it. Okay. Can I go ahead? Please say yes, because the number of yes is very low.
Sir, can I ask something? I'm sorry to unmute.
Yes, you identify yourself, but you should raise hand first, okay?
Because, sir, I'm not getting the option of raising hand today. Oh, I don't know why.
No, no problem, no problem. Ask the question.
It's showing so many options, but not showing the option of raising hand.
So it's okay. Let's ignore that. Let's stick to this. Yeah, come back.
Sir, this faster limit, is it applicable for general functions f and g or only for the polynomials?
For any function that you have seen in your L'Hopital's rule. Do you remember that? Yeah. Something like you must have seen.
Yes, sir.
Power
yes,
n, sir. Okay, and e power x, etc. You would have compared. You understand that this is not a polynomial function, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, thank you.
Yeah, yeah. We will come to that. That's why I said. No, notice that f is some function. I don't know what the function is. Do you understand that? You are seem to be forgetting. Do I know what is f here? F is some function from R to R. It is differentiable at A. That's all I know. I have no idea about how f is defined, but I was able to say this. Okay, this already answers your question. But in any case, in L'Hopital's rule, you are dealt with this kind of thing. Okay, so this is enough. Please, please review this during breakout rooms. Just go through two or three times. Any abstract concept, the way to become familiar is keep revising and break it into small, small pieces. Make sure you understand. Okay. Now what we want to talk about is functions. Okay. From R2 to R, or in general Rn to R, where n is greater than or equal to any natural number. I do not know whether any of you, how many of you know about Rn. I think concurrently vector space is going on. So all of you may know. Rn consists of ordered n tuples of real numbers. Rn consists of all numbers of all n tuples of this form. Anyway. Now these are called variables. Then you say any function f is a function of n variables. If it is a function from Rn to R. Many of you, the first question many students ask, teachers also do not explain, why I have to look at functions of more than two or three variables? Why should I look at functions of four variables or 10,000 variables for that matter? You may think mathematicians want to make life unnecessarily more difficult. But unfortunately, as I keep saying, whatever mathematics does, it is because of real life problems. Okay, remember mathematics by its very, very nature is a modeling science. It observes a pattern, abstracts a pattern, and makes it a rule or a theorem or a principle. You can apply that. Okay, for example, if you say two fingers plus three fingers, five fingers, two bananas plus three bananas, five bananas, and two chalks plus three chalks is five chalks. Now, somebody whom I trust say, she saw a two white ghosts in that room and plus three green ghosts in that room. I do not know whether ghosts exist or not. If I trust that person, okay, I don't have to go and count the ghost. I know two plus three must be five ghosts must be there. You see that? Some unknown thing also I can apply my reasoning. That's what mathematics deals with. Now, if you think why the variables come, simply variables mean, okay, how many degrees of freedom. In physics, you will talk about degrees of freedom. For example, let us look at a finished product from a factory. Okay, the price is a function of many variables. What are the variables? The input cost, the power, and the labor cost, profit the owner wants to make, GST, Already I have counted 6. Do you see that? The cost of the finished product is already a function of 6 variables. So if anything changes, it will keep changing. Right? For example, the petrol you buy, okay, for 1 liter is a function of many variables. What are the variables? The dollar cost and the exchange rate, and then n number of taxes which is imposed on them. You understand? And if you want to keep it the same price, what do you do? If the price of the petrol at the international market goes down, what do? I increase the taxes so that it remains stable. So you see that? So everything is a function of many variables in real life. So we have to learn to work with them. You should not say your physical world is only 3 dimensions. Okay. And I am sure all of you must have heard about Einstein. He, in his general theory of relativity, he wanted the universe to be 4 dimensional. And all of you must have heard at least a word, a string theory in modern physics. Okay. There are 3 different versions of string theory. In one theory, the universe is 10 dimensional. Okay. To express any phenomenon, you need 10 variables. In another, it is 11 dimensional. That means to express any phenomenon, you need 11 variables. Yet another one, it is 26 dimensional. Can you imagine all these things? See, have some fun. Okay. So if you hate mathematics, you should hate the real root cause of mathematics. Okay. Who thrust upon us all these things. But you should know that we are helping them. Okay. Now, I'm not going to spend time on this R to Rn, but let me look at a function F. Okay. There is some set, let me call it a subset A of R2 to start with, and F is a function from A to R. Right? And fix a point. Maybe I will call it this A will kind of, let me call it E. And fix a point A in E. Right? Therefore, how will I write this? Any point of E. So this is this. E may be like this. This may be my E. Start with any point. It's comma x, comma y. Therefore, f of x, comma y must be a real number. You understand this? Okay. For example, f of x, y equal to x plus y, r x times y, r e power x into y, r e power x cos y. These are all functions of 2 variables. Do all of you understand? This you must have seen. Okay. I want to jump directly into the concept of limit. Okay. Now, let's fix a point A comma B in E. Then I want to define this notion of limit xy going to AB of f of xy equal to the real number. Remember, this takes values in R, therefore this must be a real number. I want to define. Okay. I'm not going to define. You are going to define. Yeah. So let us look at how did we tackle this kind of problem. Okay. E is a subset of R, and I have to R, A is a point in E, then limit x tends to A of fx equal to L. How did I tackle this problem? I looked at L. You gave me some epsilon interval around L. Then this is my E and started with A. Then what do I have to do? I have to find a delta interval around A and so that start with any x not equal to A, then I want fx to lie here. That is, mod x minus a is less than delta. That should imply mod fx minus l should be less than epsilon. Okay, I'm just recalling your error. Now, how will I use it to define this? So, you can see mod fx, y, fx minus l, I will replace by mod fx minus l. I want this to be less than epsilon. This is all right. But what should be the counterpart of this? I need a counterpart. So this is my x. This is the point AB. Then what do I want? I want to take a point XY. Then what do I want to say? Something like, how did I interpret mod x minus a? I said it is the distance between x and a should be less than delta, and it should also be positive. So what should be the correct condition here then?
We will use the distance formula, so it will be
no, don't under say root. Distance formula, that I'll come to that later. Okay, we have okay. to know have a notion of the distance of the point xy to the point AB.
Yes, sir.
Yes, very good. So somehow I have to say distance of between, or let's say distance between the point AB and xy. So what do I want? So let us write it. D of AB xy. This is just a notation. Do not worry about this. Okay, I'm just using a notation. So I want, if this is less than delta, and also I want the point AB should not be equal to the point xy. Therefore, I want it should be at a positive distance. Then I should say fxy minus L should be less than epsilon. Do all of you understand? We have formulated the definition of a limit provided I know how to talk about distance between two points in the xy plane. That all of you have learned in your coordinate geometry. This, how will you rewrite this? This is mod x minus a whole squared plus y minus b whole squared, and then take a root. This is the distance. How many of you understand? Is that clear? Okay. So I assume that you know already the distance from high school coordinate geometry. Again, in your calculus course, you would have learned it. Now suppose I'm in R3, and let me call the point xy, x1, y1, z1, and x2, y2, z2. How will I define the distance between these two points? One way is, again, you can use geometry to arrive at, but then if I am something like r to the power 27, okay, the string theory wants 26, so r to the power 26, how will I find the distance between them? Then what do I do is, I simply use this formula and generalize that. That's what mathematicians do, right? What will I do? x1 minus x2 whole squared plus y1 minus y2 whole squared plus z1 minus z2 whole squared, and then take it its square root. I say this is the distance between these two points. In Rn, same thing, similar, but I don't want to burden you with that for the time being. Is this all right? Are all of you comfortable with the definition of limit? Now you look at examples, but is the definition clear? Do you see that it's exactly similar to the one variable case? The only thing which was missing was distance between two points in the domain. Why? Because these points are in R2, not in real line. It's R2 or R3. Then I have to make sense out of that. That we made. Is it all right? Please say yes so that I can go ahead. Let us look at this again. You must have seen it, but it may be needed for us. So let me write it. Okay. What is the meaning of saying distance between xy and AB is, let's say, less than R? I'm using R very, very deliberately. Okay. So that it will trigger your memory. What does this mean? I want to understand this geometrically. Okay. What is this definition? This definition is root of x minus a whole squared plus y minus b whole squared, that should be less than R. Therefore, if I square it, what do I get? X minus a whole squared plus y minus b whole squared must be less than r squared. So I have a point AB here. Okay, this is my AB. Let me make it a different color. Okay, and I take a point XY. What do I want? It should be at a distance at most r. So what does it say? With the AB, you draw a circle of radius r. This may not look like a circle. Okay. This is radius r. So what does it mean? If I say distance between XY and AB is less than r, it is same as saying the point XY lies within the circle. The circle with center AB, radius r. Do all of you understand this? I am sure all of you must have seen this in your calculus course also. So, but this geometry is important. Okay. So when I want to say, this is my point. Maybe I'll use a strikingly different color. Yeah. Okay. This is my point AB. This is my arbitrary point XY. So when I want to say mod FXY minus L is less than epsilon, I need a delta wall. That means there is a delta radius at the point you look for XY must be inside this. So if XY lies in this, and it's not equal to this pink point AB, then what do I want? Fx minus L should be less than epsilon. That is same as saying your Fx lies somewhere here. This is the geometric way of looking at what we wrote using inequality and analysis analytically. Do all of you agree with that? Okay. So that means there is nothing like directions. You see that? So let me look at, let me see whether I want to draw a picture, circle. Yeah. Okay. So this is my point AB, right? So I start with any XY, it may be anywhere here. Right, there is nothing like a particular direction it has to reach. For example, in the case of R, if A is here, then you talk about X coming from the right or X coming from the left. The limit wants X to come from any side. You understand that? But there are sides. The notion of side does not exist here. Okay, there are too many directions. So it can come in any direction, but whenever XY lies within the circle, then mod fx minus L should be less than epsilon. Okay. This definition is all right, but how do I work with it? This is where many students have problem. Let us look at it. This is where two things. So suppose if some function is given and the point AB is in E, then I want limit XY going to AB of FXY. Okay. I want you to find. This is how your textbook may give find. Okay. Now there are two problems. What is the first problem? If you told me this limit equal to L, then it's a verification problem. I only have to say the limit is equal to L. That's a verification. Now, if you ask me to find, there is an extra burden for me. What is the extra burden? I have to know, first of all, whether limit exists. I don't know. Then, if the limit exists, then I have to find an L, and I show this limit is L. You see that? Whereas, when you say equal to L, my job is easy. You already said the limit exists, and it is equal to L. I only have to verify that's a correct statement. Whereas if you want me to say find limit XY going to AB as FXY, then I have extra work. How many of you appreciate the difficulty? Because we are going to explain how to resolve this. Yes, Shivani. Is there any doubt?
No, it was a mistake.
Okay, okay. Right. See, there is a golden rule in mathematics. You must have heard the word golden ratio. What is the golden rule? I have some unknown problem. Then what do? I reduce to a problem which is simpler, which I have solved. Okay, you reduce this problem to this problem, known problem, which I know how to solve it. Or look for a problem which is very similar to that, which I know how to solve, and try to see whether the same kind of trick can apply here in the unknown problem. This is the standard golden rule of mathematics. I'm sure all of you are aware of that, right? One is reduce to simpler problem which you had already solved, or look for an analogous problem which you know how to solve it and try to see whether that trick or the method in the analogous problem can be adapted to the unknown problem. Unknown problem is problem is known, solution is unknown, unsolved problem rather. Okay. Do all of you understand this? Now, what is that I want? I want to know limit xy going to ab of fx. Okay. I want to know whether how to find the limit. If you say find the limit, I do not know whether the limit exists. At next, if the limit exists, what it should be? I have no idea. Then what will I do? As I said, the standard trick is try to reduce to a problem which you already know how to solve. What is the problem I already know how to solve in this case? Can somebody tell me? How will I reduce this problem to some problem which I already know how to solve? Yes? Come on. Do not be shy and do not be afraid of me saying something wrong. Okay. In fact, you should never be afraid of making mistakes. If you are afraid of making mistakes, you will never learn anything. Can somebody tell me?
So we can apply the definition that we just read.
No, then that's it. There is nothing more. No. The definition, if I want to apply it, remember the L should, I should know L. You never gave me L, so how can I apply the definition? You understood? So there was a problem there.
Fix one variable and then make it a function of one variable and then try to see like...
That's right. Very good. That's one trick. Okay? One trick. Who is this?
Sir Rachna.
Is it a student?
No.
Oh, okay. So one is fix one other variable, then it is a function of the other variable. I'll come to that. Students should get used to that. There is another method, reduce to one variable altogether. Okay. This is one variable, this is one trick, but I'm going to say reduce it to one variable altogether. How do I do that? So what I have is, let me take AB is zero just for the simplicity. And let us look at this. Okay. Let my point x comma y lie on this line, but it goes to this point 0, 0. Yeah. You understand? And any line like this of the form y equal to mx. You understand that? Therefore, this is any point here is of the form x comma mx. Therefore, what do I have now? F of xy for y on this, okay, for the point xy on this line is going to be f of x comma mx. See, m is fixed slope. This is constant for every point here. Therefore, it's not a variable. Therefore, this is actually a function of one variable. Therefore, I can ask for what is limit? Yeah, x goes to 0 of fx mx. Now, notice that this is a function of only one variable. Do not be afraid. I will look at very concrete examples so that you will become comfortable. Okay, all abstract theory is very nice. Okay, let us look at the first suggestion one of the teachers made. Let us look at, I already gave you an example. Suppose my function is f of xy equal to x times y, right? At the point a, b, I want, right? Then what can I do? I can fix one of the variable, keep the variable y to be b. Then it is f of x, always y is always b. Therefore, what is this? Xb. Do you understand that? Now this is a function of one variable, right? Therefore, limit x tends to a of xb is what I am looking at. What is this? This is ab. Do you understand this? How many of you understand what I am doing? Please say yes if you understand. See, I got the thing, answer. In fact, I don't know to prove that also, at least in this case, but there is a lot more work. I'll come to that. Do you understand this? Very good. Now, maybe I should also check the other case. Suppose I fix the x variable equal to a, then it is going to be f. Okay, always a, but this will be y. Therefore, I will have a y. Then limit x, this is a y going to a b of a y. What is this? This is same as limit y going to b of a y, that is also a b. So what did I do? I have this point a b here. Okay, and what did I do here? I fixed y equal to b. So I am approaching my point x comma b. That approaches the point a b here. If I go along this direction, it's a function of only one variable. See, it's a function only on this line. Okay, then I get the limit as a b. Or I can come this way, fix a and allow this to vary. Therefore, this is going to be a comma y for every point. Let it go towards a b. Then also I get the limit as a b. So my guess is maybe this is the limit exists. It is equal to a b. I do not know whether it's still correct. How many of you understand this? So I have made a guess. The limit may exist. Of xy may exist, and it is L. What is L? L is AB. This is my guess. There is still, we have to prove that. How many of you appreciate this? Yeah. Okay. Right. Now suppose I look at the same thing with the other one. This is going to be slightly complicated. I hope all of you can understand. Now, what do I want? I want to approach this by any line like this. The slope is m, okay? The slope is m here. When I write m, this is tan theta, but I'm just writing this. So I'm trying to approach this point, AB, via this line. Can somebody tell me what should be the, how do I write the points here? Okay, this is your 12th standard coordinate geometry. It has to, this line has to pass through the point AB with slope m. Therefore, you know y equal to mx plus c. M I know, and it has to pass through the point AB. Therefore, when x equal to a, it must be ma plus c. Therefore, I know what is c now, right? C is going to be b minus ma. Therefore, it is going to y equal to mx plus b minus ma, which is m into x minus a plus b. Do all of you agree with this? Are you sure? Yes? Did I make some mistake? You understand? Therefore, any point here, okay, is of the form x. Once you give me x, y has to be only this. You understand? Therefore, if along this point, what will be my f of xy? F of xy equal to x into y. But what is x? x is x, but y has to be m into, let me write m into x minus a plus b. So let me write it, I am not writing it correctly. X into m x minus a plus b, that is equal to m x into x minus a plus xb. You understand this? It became a function of one variable. How many of you understand? I am sure none of you have done this. How many of you understand this function? So yeah, the function f, when I move along this line whose slope is m through ab, then it's a function of only one variable x. And what is that function? It is mx into x minus a plus xb. Do all of you understand this? Take some time. I'll stop within 2 minutes with this example. I went past time. You understand? I'm working a very concrete case. Okay? When I restrict along the line y equal to something like mx, what happens? Right? Now, therefore, limit xy going to a comma b, where xy lies in this line, whatever this line of fxy is same as limit x tends to a of this mx into x minus a plus xb. Okay, now as x tends to a, this is going to go to zero because this is continuous function, and this goes to ab. So we found that. How many of you appreciate that? So if I approach what we did earlier, as your teacher said, I looked at only these two lines. But I said I can take any line through the point AB. Then if I approach AB through any of these lines, the limit turns out to be this number AB. So my suspicion is much stronger now. So the limit should exist. And possibly, and if it exists, it should be AB. Do all of you agree with that? We will prove it tomorrow using epsilon and delta. Please tell me how many of you understood this. Please go through these things. Okay, you can, I'll stop sharing. So please go through this, and I will send the PDF file to Dr. Shweta Gandhi. She will mail it to you, and use the discussion room or the breakout room to understand it. Okay. When you come back, I'll have a poll. And do not worry about trying to solve problems at present. It's like trying to say, I do not even know how to stand or walk. I want to run. Or I want to take 100 meter dash in Olympics. Okay, don't do that. Go slow. You will see, once you learn these things, how fast we are going to go from third and fourth lecture onwards. You'll be very surprised. We took a lot of pain in this beginning so that all your concepts should become very crystal clear. When I say it won't be, it is only about 30-40%. If you are very good, it may be 60-70%. But still, you have to work on that. Okay.